Well, good morning, church. You can do better than that. Good morning, church. As a friend of mine says, good morning, saints, and good morning, sinners, right? We're all more like the sinners crowd. Take out your church information document we call the SID, and to highlight a couple of things, I want to start with an apology. Last Sunday, I talked about the state champion wrestling team and failed to mention the cheerleader team from Union County placed and went to nationals. So congratulations to the Union County cheerleaders. Yeah, absolutely. And the boys basketball team won the district, beat Henderson County. That's awesome. How did the girls do? Do we know? They lost. All right, so we won't talk about that. All right. Just to let you know, there's a special call business meeting that's scheduled for right after church, right here. We'll do it right after worship or as part of worship at the end next Sunday, and we'll be doing that to elect individuals for the search team for our part-time music worship pastor position, and that will be next week. I know Brother Bill has a Crossings meeting next Sunday as well. With parents, kids, anybody going to the Crossings camp this summer. He's also got a lock-in scheduled for March 15th, so a lot going on and for that. So we're already getting excited about Vacation Bible School. That was a slide that was up there today. So if you've got any questions about that or you're willing to volunteer, I'm sure Diane Arnett would be glad to take your application right now. And you don't need to apply. You just want to, if you're breathing, we'll take you. We'll find a job for you to do, and we would love to have you. That'll be in June, and that'll be here before you know it. Let's stand up, and let's greet each other for just a few moments. Welcome each other to church. You ready to pray?
So I don't start too fast.
Let's go to the Lord and start worship. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity that we have today to worship you, not out of duty, obligation, but because we desire. And our passion is to glorify our God. An audience of one today. Our primary focus, our only thought, is how can we worship you? How can we lift your praises? How can we grow as Christians and serve you better? What are the core needs that we have in our life, and what are our values? What do we put as a priority in our life? And God, if it's not you, help us to focus laser-like today on that and to give you praise in all things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning.
That was weak.
Come on.
Good morning.
That's better, but still not real good. You ready?
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord, yes,
but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure, that his joy is gonna be my strength. Oh, the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. We sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Sing it again. Enthusiasm is
lost, I was in chains, world had a hold of me, my heart was a stone, I was covered in shame, when he came for me, I couldn't run from his presence, I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be, he loves me, he is for. It was a fire deep in my soul, I'll never be the same. I stepped out of the dark into the light when he called my name. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be, he loves me, he is for me. Holds the stars and he holds my heart with healing hands that bear scars, the rugged cross where he died for me, my only hope, my everything. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can
I love children because they're so brutally honest. I was walking through GLL about half a year ago, And one of the kids was sitting at the table and said, "Dr. Bill, Dr. Bill." I know, that's what they call me. I don't know why. It's better than Butter Bill, but Dr. Bill. And I went over, "Yes?" And they looked at me seriously and said, "Do you only have one shirt?" I looked at him, I said, "No, I don't. I just happen to have like 10 to 15 of these same style shirts, but I promise you, I wear a clean one every day." "Okay." Another one I walked through. One of them said, "You know, my granddad wears sweaters like that." So, you know, I just, you know, sometimes they're so brutally honest. But, you know, I noticed this about kids. This is a cool part. It's part of their nature to be that because they get like us when we get a little older, the filter's gone. But sometimes what they say, you know, you can get a lot from it. I've been at Walmart many times looking in the toy section for die-cast cars. Of course, children and their parents are over there. And I've never heard a child say to their parent, "Mother, father, see this Transformer or whatever it is nowadays? I need this." They never say that. I want. That's all I hear coming out. I want. You know? So kids know what they want. And you know, as a parent, sometimes they don't know what they need. And there's a difference. And so we're going to talk today, the pastor is on the perspective of knowing what you desire and value versus a want, need, or what is important to you in your values. And I have to admit, I've been getting addicted to watching these videos about living big in a tiny house. I don't know if you ever looked at those on YouTube. This guy named, he's an Australian, and he goes all over the world, and he interviews these people who have built little tiny houses. And the thing I noticed about all of them is they're trying to live more simple. They have to decide what they have in values and what is their priority in life. And for many of them, they're trying to scale down. Because what we value is what we're going to want. And so today, I think we're going to look at what do you want? And that's probably what you value. Because the Bible says where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And so let's see today, what do you value? What do you want in this life God's given you? Let's pray. I love children, Jesus, because they can tell it like it is. But Lord, your word tells it like it is too. And so today as we hear your words from Pastor Tim about what we value and our perspective on what's important, help us to ask ourselves, what do I value? What do I desire? Is it what you want, Jesus? And may we be found wanting what you want. In your name we pray. Amen.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. On that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me, now my soul rise up, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sin of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem, and reconcile the very ones who did that tree. Oh, that rugged
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of the Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Pray with me. Father, we are here praising you, praising our Savior. Our story is yours, Father, because until you came into our lives, we were lost. That's why we should be praising you. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day, and we thank you for the rain, even though we didn't ask for it. But you know best. You have a purpose for the wind last night, and it's not us our place to question that, Father, but thank you for this day. Thank you for this church family, Father. We just ask that you bless these ties, direct us, guide us, and we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Superlative words, making the most clever rhymes, wouldn't amount to much, just wouldn't count for much if you can't read between lines. But I have discovered, I finally uncovered a most significant thing. It's unknowable. We love. What matters most is how much we give. What would it matter if we just live without loving our God, without loving each other? Faith, hope, and love, especially love. That's what matters most. What matters most. In a curious world, learning the meaning of life. Tell me, what is the reason, and why do the seasons keep turning the pages of time? I had to discover the things from above, for the days turn so quickly. What matters most is how much we give. What would it matter if we just live without loving our God, without loving each other? Oh, not money, not power, not fame or position.
Especially
What matters? What matters most in your life? What matters most today? Is what matters is seeing your friends this morning? Maybe talk about the ball game? Is that what matters most? Sharing with our neighbor? Maybe focus on God, maybe not. What matters most? What is the most important thing in your life? I wonder sometimes if we lose perspective on what matters the most. It seems everything and everyone is sometimes more important than our God. We're so concerned with the horizontal, we have forgotten all about the vertical. You see, without God, there is no horizontal. There's no cross without the vertical. It points straight to God. And also points straight to okay. So what matters, you could say, is the vertical line. But what we tend to think about is the horizontal. I get to see my neighbor. I get to do this. I get to do that. I get to accomplish this task. I get to do this. I get to do that. I, everywhere you hear, it is about us. Even worship can become about us, what I prefer, what songs I would like to hear, what I would like to see. I. We have lost what really matters. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, the greatest of these is love. Faith, hope, and love, and especially love, is the greatest. That's what matters the most. That's what's going to be in eternity. What you love the most are things that are going to be held on. Your faith and your hope. If you want to live an extraordinary life, I mean, get beyond the humdrum of your day-to-day existence. If you want to live beyond what we've always done, to be greater than we've ever been, to expand our ministries and our church to another level, I mean, to be extraordinary. It's okay to be okay. If you want to be an okay church, okay. I don't want to just be an okay pastor. I don't want to serve in a just okay church. If that's where you are, then you need to be honest with God. I'm okay with okay. We've talked about it now for 2 months. We've talked about waiting on God and knowing your purpose and influencing your culture as opposed to having the culture influence us. These are all biblical thematic things. And we have to figure out today what really matters the most in our life. The story is told about a gung-ho drill sergeant. You've seen these guys in the movie. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with the color. You're seeing yellow because we're having a technical issue, and we'll figure that out by next Sunday. I promise you, or someone I know will be very pained. It's my son back there. He'll figure it out. There's a gung-ho drill sergeant one day, and he's always wanting the best from his soldiers. And you know how drill sergeants are. I mean, they're just rough and tough. One day, in kind of a pained disbelief, he saw a sloppy squad of new recruits wearing their uniforms for the very first time. And for a moment, the sergeant was speechless with rage. I mean, he's just quivering. It kind of reminds me of the old Gomer Pyle series. Remember Sergeant Carter? How many of y'all remember Sergeant Carter? How many of y'all are too young to even know what I'm talking about? Bless your heart. I can't hear you. Yes, sir. I can't hear you. So he's screaming at him, and he yells out in frustration, Just step out here and look at yourselves. Now, I don't know how I expected them to step out and look at themselves, but the basic concept was on target. There's a time when all of us should step out and take a good look, a good hard look at ourselves. The psalmist David would say it this way, "Examine my heart, God, that I might become pure before you." I wonder if we do that. Do we examine our hearts before we walk into the doors of this sanctuary or enter worship or anything or get on our knees to pray? Do we really come to God in reverence? Or does what matter to you is connecting with other people? What matters to you is the weather, the rain, the flooding. What matters to you is the ball game, the scores. And all of those things are fine, but what matters the most? That's what we need to figure out today. If you want to live an okay life, you can do that. But if you want to live an extraordinary life, we're going to have to take a hard, good hard look at ourselves. You see, we have to gain a perspective of what matters. This is the final Sunday in this series. And I couldn't finish without this point. We have to gain a perspective of what really matters in life. One of the convicted co-conspirators of the Watergate scandal made a remarkable confession. I quote, he said, "I have lived 50 years of my life." 50 years of his life. Think about it. Without ever really coming to grips with the very basic questions of what is and what is not important to me, what is and what is not right and wrong, what is and what is not valuable and worthwhile. Can you imagine living your life for 50 years and not really knowing what is right and what is wrong? I mean, really knowing. That you would spend 50 years of your life meandering, that you would spend 50 years of your life in Sunday school, in going to church, in watching Christian TV or listening to K-Love, you would spend all of this time and not really know who you are and what really, really matters. You can wear the Christian T-shirt and still not know what matters. You can wear a cross necklace and still don't know who you are. You can pretend to be a church and still not be a church. This man lived 50 years without stepping out and taking a good look, hard look at himself. So I hope you and I don't make that mistake. In fact, I want you to do something for me. Actually, it's for you. I want each of you to take out a piece of paper. It could be the SID. It could be a receipt in your wallet. I don't care. It doesn't have to be very big. Everybody should be finding a piece of paper. I love it when the pastor asks, it's like you're not even hearing me. And I love the people who say, "I ain't budging." Fine. You ever heard the statement, you get out of it what you put into it? If you're okay with just being okay, just sit there and relax. It'll be over in about 20 minutes. If you really want to get something out of today, find something to write on and find something to write with. And I want you to, this is not something that your neighbor's going to share. I don't want anyone looking over at their spouse to see what they wrote. Or a friend. This is between you and God. I want you to write down three words. And these three things are the highest values in your life. If money, I want you to be honest with God. If money is a value, then write money. If family is a value, then write down family. If your friends are your highest value, put down friends. But if God is your in your value range, make sure that you and God are on the right path with that. Because he knows. So take us just a moment, take a good look at yourself and write it down. What are your three highest values? what matters most in my life? Thank you. Wake up back there. Human behavior is driven by two forces, needs and values. You and I have certain needs. Some of these are physical needs. We all know that. You need food, water, shelter, etc. Some of our needs are emotional. We want to be loved. We want to be accepted. We want to be recognized. We need power in our life. There are certain needs that we have. We all have needs. Some of these are immediate. Some are overwhelming. When we are without food or water, we will do almost anything to satisfy our needs for the staples of life. Unless we have these needs met, we're going to die. Try to live without water and food for a while and see what happens. Most of our emotional needs can be overwhelming, and maybe not, but they can leave us dissatisfied. There's always something more. It seems like it's never enough. But if we're not careful, our emotional needs can even be destructive. In his younger days, Herbert von Karajanwood, our world-renowned conductor of the Berlin Philharmonic, he declared that he would sacrifice his grandmother if necessary, to fulfill what he called his musical mission. His mission later drove him to join the Nazi Party in Germany. And after World War II, he explained away his membership in the party as merely an opportunistic career move. How much damage he may have done in order to satisfy this mission, his need for recognition in the musical world, we will never know. Chuck Colson, who since passed away in 2012, when he was a political advisor for Richard Nixon, he was famous during Watergate days for saying almost the same thing. He said, "I would step on my mother in order to see the president reelected." He eventually turned his life around after spending some time in prison with Watergate stuff, and he became a very bold witness for Christ. Colson disgraced himself and he disappointed the American people because of his misguided need for power. All of us have needs. And those needs, both physical and emotional, those are God-given. The needs that you have, God gives us those. And they're necessary for survival. But if they get out of hand, they can become killers and they can kill us. So our values are a little different. Our values carry an element of choice. We choose a set of values by which we live our lives. I don't know what you listed as your three highest values. Some of you may have listed God. Some of others may be family. Some of you may have listed honesty or freedom or respect for others. You know, Bob Simon from CBS, he learned a valuable lesson. He was captured by the Iraqis once. And at several points during his captivity, his jailers told him, "We're going to kill you." And Bob Simon said that during his imprisonment, he spent a lot of time looking back on his life, on what really mattered. And he began to realize that he didn't measure his life in terms of his journalistic accomplishments, his awards, his income, the famous people that he had interviewed or met, the fabulous places that he had eaten at or seen. He said, "What kept coming back to me over and over and over that wouldn't leave his mind were the thoughts of his family. Like the times he had spent walking with his little daughter along the beach." For Bob Simon, family was an important value as it is for many of us. Former President Jimmy Carter was asked by reporters if the night he won the presidential election in the 70s would go down as the happiest moment in his life. And he responded, "No, it is not," without even hesitating. He said, "It was the birth of my children, and especially the Carter's daughter, Amy, had been born. He and his sons, the youngest, then 15 years old, they were so excited they woke up everyone in Plains, Georgia, because the love of family was his value. And so was love and honesty, tolerance, and many other standards by which people live their lives. We all have needs and we all have values. Living an extraordinary life may be defined as the ability to be either values-driven or needs-driven. You're going to hear that a lot today if you haven't already. Values and needs. What drives you? Is it your needs or your values? A person that is just okay with an okay life is usually driven by their needs. How can I fulfill my physical needs? Needs for food, shelter. How can I meet my emotional needs? Needs for recognition, power, security, my agenda, my dreams, my desires. I. If you are a needs-driven person, the other people are simply objects that you use to satisfy whatever needs you need and are. We try to use people to get where we want to go. You start becoming a person that wants to live an extraordinary life when you are able to overcome your needs and place your values on top of your needs. For example, one of your needs may be acceptance of others. It just drives you crazy when you don't feel accepted. Suppose you're a teenager. One of the needs that teens have today is the acceptance by their peers. There's a lot of pressure. That's not a surprise. Suppose you are a young person and the other young people that you look up to for acceptance, well, they get into some bad behavior. They begin to shoplift a little bit at the local store. And you come under intense pressure to conform to the group, and you try to decide, do I shoplift as well to fit in? But then one of your values in life is thou shalt not steal. So do you listen to your needs? Or do you listen to your values? The mark of maturity, spiritual maturity, is the ability to have your values outweigh your needs. And maturity has very little to do with age. I have known some teenagers in my life who are more values-driven than many adults. For a Christian, the highest value is God. Didn't Jesus say, seek first what? The kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven. From a spiritual perspective, you have reached the highest level of maturity when you are able to pray that God's will be done in your life, even if all of your needs are not met in return. We kind of have this theology in life that I'll meet your needs if you meet my needs. I'll be glad to work in Vacation Bible School, but I need a promotion over here. So we barter with God, right? It's like the guy from the old movie, The End, I think Dom DeLuise, who's also passed. You remember the movie when he's swimming and he's out in the ocean and he pleads with God, I'll do anything you want me to do. Just get me back to the shore. So he swims and he swims and he swims. And the closer he gets, he goes, well, I'll serve you part of the way. I'm almost there now. And by the time he gets to the shore, we're good, God. I don't need you now. And that's kind of how we are. We need God the most at the most critical times in our life. But when we don't need God, we're okay with being okay. I'll call you if I need you. See, the problem with that is that's not full devotion to God. Remember, Jesus was in the garden before his crucifixion. He had a need, like all humans. He was fully human and fully God. You know what one of his greatest needs was? Self-preservation. Do you really think Jesus wanted to die? You think he woke up and said, kill me, stab me, I'm good, I'm ready? If that were the case, why did he get on his knees and pray so hard that he began to have sweat of blood come down? He was worried sick about the pain that was going to come. Father, if there's any other way, anyway, take this cup from me. But then the other foot drops, and I'm so glad, aren't you? But not my will be done, but yours. Not in our culture. Not your will be done. My will be done. I'll be doing it, done it how I want to do it and done it. This is my life. This is what I'm going to do. Not your will. I'm going to do my will. I'm not going to do your will. I'm going to do what I want and what I desire and what I choose. And what matters the most to me is not you. See, if we could ever get to that point where we really come to grips with that and totally transparent, as if we're faking God out somehow because God doesn't see the soul of our hearts, and really get honest with God and say, God, you and I mean, I'm not putting you as the most important thing in my life. That's a step in the right direction. The problem that we have in the 21st century church is we say we have God as a priority and that we live as if we don't bother with him at all. And you can tell that through our human natures and attitudes and actions. Because if we were more Christ-like, we would be a lot more loving and caring and gentle and kindness and self-control. Just look up the fruits of the Spirit in Galatians. We would see a lot more of that. Guess what? We're just now getting to the Scripture. Turn with me to Mark's Gospel, chapter 8. You might be here all day. I hope you packed a lunch. Please stand with me. No, I'm just teasing. I've just decided to do this at this point. The last time we looked at this was last year in August. It's not that I have a good memory, it's just that I write down the dates of all the scriptures I share. Then calling the crowd to join his disciples, Jesus said this: if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways and take up your cross and follow me. By the way, he didn't say take up my cross. Take up your cross. If you try to hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message in these adulterous and sinful days, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Pray with me. God, as we conclude, as we start to wind down today's teaching, maybe that is a priority that we need to really consider what matters most. Do our souls matter the most? And if not, what's more important than our soul? Where we would spend eternity? What kind of kingdom impact we will make? What's more important than that? We love you and we need you today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I am telling you, this is not easy. Sharing it's not easy. Listening to it, I know, is not easy. What does Jesus mean when he says you need to deny yourself? Does he mean that we're to listen to our values only and not our needs? Is that what self-denial is all about? Let me tell you what self-denial is not about. Lent season's coming up, right? I don't know, some of you practice Lent, some of you don't. But it's a time before Easter where we give up things for a certain amount of time as a spiritual. Let me tell you what self-denial is not. Self-denial is not, I'm going to give up chocolates until after Easter. I'm going to give up TV shows. I'm going to get off Facebook. Ooh, that's a big struggle. Some people really say, that's what I'm doing for Lent. I'm giving up all social media. Ooh, you really stepped out there. Boy, that's a big one. Self-denial is not saying, I won't deal without chocolate. It might be good for your waistline, but that's not the kind of self-denial that Jesus had in mind. Self-denial is about stepping out from ourselves and asking the question, am I being driven by my needs or my values? And it means acknowledging that our highest value is to do the will of God. So here's where we've come to. All of us are driven by needs and values. Living an extraordinary life means elevating our values over our needs. Christian faith means that our highest value should be God. Now I want you to go back and look at your three highest values that you selected and wrote down in the beginning of this message. I'm going to assume that there were some good values in there. So the next logical question that I have for you is this. Is there a specific commitment that you can make today to one of your core values? Your core values, not mine. Recognizing that true maturity in Jesus comes when we become values-driven over needs-driven, is there a commitment that you can make to a values-driven life? For example, if you listed your family as one of your values, is there some particular commitment you need to make to your family that you can make today? If you listed God as your highest value, is there a particular commitment that you would make to God today? Today's worship service can have a significant impact on our lives if you will come away with just one commitment. And while you consider this request, I want to finish with a story that I thought was fascinating. Carrie Chapman Catt. Carrie Chapman Catt was one of the crusaders for women's suffrage. For those of you that did not know what that is, that's women's right to vote. There was a time in our country when women were not allowed by law to vote. Do not throw things at me. I'm just the messenger. And I didn't live back in those days. Carrie spent years of her life working tirelessly to earn this right for women. Everywhere she went, she faced hostility, ridicule, and isolation. She was a young school teacher in Mason City, Iowa, and she began a petition to allow women the right to vote in local elections, a move that brought her to the attention of the world-known Susan B. Anthony. What did Susan B. Anthony do? Dollar coin, oh, that's good. What did Susan B. Anthony do? What was she known for? She might have helped with the flag. She might have helped with the country. She might have helped with the government. She might have helped with history. She might have helped with a bunch of things in her life. It was actually, she passed the baton to this lady that actually got the vote for women in place. Slowly, state by state, the House of Representatives held a vote for women's suffrage on January 10th, 1918. So persuasive had Carrie been that many representatives braved personal hardships. It was not popular to vote. A representative from New York had been urged by his dying wife to travel to Washington to go vote. Another representative from Tennessee suffered a broken arm, insisted on voting for the amendment before he would go to the hospital and seek medical treatment. Another representative hospitalized for the last 6 months dragged himself to the House of Representatives just long enough to vote for suffrage. And when it was announced that the vote for women's suffrage had passed, the House of Representatives, Carrie Chapman, stood up in the middle of all those men, and she began to sing, praise God from whom all blessings flow, all creatures here be all, Him, the heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. That was actually quite beautiful. I say we all go to New York this week. Let's get on a bus. Let's get in there and let's all sing together. Would that not be awesome? We would all be in prison together. As a church, you think we'd get any news coverage? Probably not. Except the pastor would be found dead by his own parishioners, film at 11. Self-denial has nothing to do with giving up chocolates. It has everything to do with basic decisions that each of us have to make. Are we going to be driven by our needs or our values? Self-denial is not just what we are willing to surrender, like giving up something. The key is, what are we going to gain in life based on our commitment? See, that's what most people don't understand about fasting. There are diets now on social media, and one of them is just fasting, like skipping a meal. Like, that wasn't known 300 years ago. Duh, if you skip a meal, you might lose a few pounds. Spiritual fasting, now pay attention. Spiritual fasting is not doing something like eating, it could be something else, and replacing it with time with God. Those of you who are just skipping lunch and giving the glory to God, that's not doing anything for the kingdom of God, period. Oh, I'm going to skip a breakfast for Jesus today. Proud of you. It means nothing. Replacing time with breakfast and your favorite four cups of coffee, Starbucks, dark blend, a little bit of cream. Where'd you go? I love that post this week. If you give that up and you replace it with time in prayer, that's fasting. Or you give up watching CNN or Fox or whatever newscast because you can't wait to get your daily fix, and you spend that 30 minutes in prayer and reading the Bible, that's fasting. That's self-denial. That's following the will of God. It's not just giving up something. It is adding something that we would value as something that God would matter as valuable. And even beyond commitment, I really close with this idea. What are you devoted to? I can't tell. I hope God can tell. I can't tell sometimes. I could go by person in this church, row by row, and sometimes I would not be able to understand what you are literally devoted to do. In other words, where is your passions? What do you get excited about? Because I'm going to tell you what it wasn't this morning. It was the way we worship today. And Steve had to re-crank us up a couple times. Dude, I want to get a big Arnold's his arm things and go. What are you devoted to? What are you here for? And where are we going? Where do you put your passions and your interest? How many of you watched that game last night, yesterday afternoon? Anybody watch the Kentucky game? Did you see PJ stroking those threes from the top of the key? I went, dude, where was that last year? Did anybody see it besides me? When he got to that kind of the next one, he thought he was going to make them all, did he not? And he got it from the side corner, and he launched one from 35 feet, wasn't even close to the three-point line. And he just knew it was going to go in. And he wanted to hear the ovation from the crowd. And he wanted that excitement. And he struck it, and it just barely drew iron. And he missed it. It was okay. He had a tremendous game. I don't know if you were like that, but I was on the seat of my couch going, I want this to go in, man. I want my neighbors to hear this. I'm screaming from everything I'm worth. I wanted everybody to know he had mad. I was like, oh my goodness. Dude is on fire. Do we ever get that passionate for God ever? Yay, God. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. You know what the difference between a golf clap is and an ovation? Do you? Everybody golf clap for me. That's you so much. Now let's give God praise. Is there a difference? We should be ovation people, Christians, but most of the time we're golf clap Christians. And the world doesn't understand what the big fuss is about. To live the extraordinary life, place your devotion to Christ.
Full devotion.
Full devotion.
Full devotion.
Full devotion.
Full devotion.
What is full devotion? Can you be completely devoted to something? We live in a promises were made to be broken society.
Divorce is so common it's a shock when we hear a couple has been married more than 25,
15,
or even 10 years.
Our parents and grandparents worked for the same company for 40 years. Today the average is about 8.
When I was growing up, I played on the same baseball team with the same kids.
From the time I was 6 until I turned 12.
Now kids change from one sport to another, then another, going from team to team to team.
I know those things sound silly, but when you look at the world around us, is there any devotion to anything anymore?
Well, about 5 years ago, I looked at my own life.
When I did, I didn't like what I saw.
Oh, I talked a good game.
You sit me in a small group, and I tell you what you wanted to hear.
I talk about things like Bible study and prayer.
I'd come and help with a special event if you really needed me to.
I criticize others around me and hold them accountable for their actions.
But then I started to understand what the term full devotion really meant.
I was confusing devotion with commitment. A commitment is a duty or pledge to something or someone.
But devotion, full devotion, is being enthusiastically and passionately dedicated and loyal to something.
I'm not fully devoted to Christ because of a sense of duty. Jesus didn't come to the earth to die because of some pledge he made.
He came to the earth to die because he is enthusiastically and passionately dedicated to us.
To you and me, to all of mankind.
I'm fully devoted to Christ because he was first fully devoted to me. Because of that, he calls me to live a life that is a mirror image of his.
And if I'm going to become like Christ, I've got to be enthusiastically and passionately fully devoted to him. There's no other way.
So you ask, what does full devotion look like?
It means I formed a relationship with my neighbor that doesn't know God.
It means I'm intentional about setting aside time each morning to just talk and listen to God.
It means I told my small group about my addiction to porn.
It means I show up to church at 7 a.m. to run a video camera.
It means I downsized my home so that I could afford to give more.
Full devotion is not saying you're going to do something. It's actually doing something.
It's actually doing something.
It's actually doing something.
It's actually doing something. The Bible says, watch what God does, and then you do it. Like children who learn proper behavior from their parents.
Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love.
Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious, but extravagant.
He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us.
Love like that. That's why I'm fully devoted to Christ.
That's why I'm fully devoted to Christ.
That is why I'm fully devoted to Christ.
That's why I'm fully devoted to Christ.
Full devotion to God is not saying I'll do something, but actually doing something. Let's pray. Father, if we will totally be transparent and honest today, we are not fully devoted followers of Christ. We want to be. We often desire to be, but we lack. We are sin-filled, self-interest, me-driven. And God, what we really need today is a fresh spirit, a revival, an awakening, a fresh wind of the Holy Spirit. Even if it just begins in one heart, it will be worth it. We ask your blessings on those who will be making decisions, eternal decisions today. In Christ's name, amen. First and foremost, if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, you've never accepted Christ in your heart, we would just invite you to do that today. Now, the Bible says that professing him publicly is the next logical step in obedience. And that's what we do here. You don't come through me. I'm just here to help you. Coming public with your statement, that's what God calls us to do. Or perhaps if you need to refocus your life, sometimes people call it rededication, recommitment, however you want to state it. Sometimes we just need to refocus. The problem with that is that our refocus sometimes gets cyclical, and we get refocused, and then we get onto self, and then we get refocused, and we never really repent, so we don't really change the cycle. We don't change. Today could be just a breathtaking, radical change in your life if you will allow God to do that. If this is this morning you've decided to join this church, we would love to have you. This is the time that you would come forward and make that decision. If you want to come here and pray here, you're more than welcome to do that. We would greatly appreciate the ability to pray with you. We're honored to do that. And if you want to be okay, just be okay. But if you want to be extraordinary, have your full devotion in God. I invite you to stand and respond to God's invitation today.
No height or death can separate your steadfast love, who can escape your faithfulness and endless sea, so full of grace and mercy. We sing, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He is so good to me. No height or depth can separate your steadfast love, who can escape your faithfulness and endless sea, so full of grace and mercy. We sing, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. God is so good. God is so good. God. Steadfast love, who can escape your faithfulness and endless sea, so full of grace and mercy. We sing, God is so good. God is so good. God.
Are you looking forward to March? I am. Hopefully we'll get out of this rain and start heading towards spring. I know in a couple weeks it'll be like, move your clock forward. Can you believe that? Isn't that the 10th or whatever that weekend? That's going to be unbelievable. Just I like to fall back an hour, but I like the weather better when we spring forward. So I'm all excited about that. Hope that you'll be a part of our Wednesday night activities. We'll be back in Bible study in the book of John this Wednesday at 6 o'clock. We always end at 7, if not before. Hope that you'll come and be a part of our Wednesday night. We love to have you come be a part of that experience. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Let's worship as we exit. Just kind of hang there. Let's worship, and then we'll exit together. All right, Steve?
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. We sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen.
Sing that again.
We sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.